بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. طيب, we start inshallah the class of fiqh, and today the first hadith that we'll study. وعن معاوية قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم العين وكاء السهم العين وكاء السهم فإذا نامت العينان استطلق الوكاء. رواه أحمد والطبراني. Narrated معاوية said, Allah's messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم said, the eye is the leather strap of the anus, right? Okay, and when the eyes sleep, the leather strap is loosened. Related by Ahmad and at-Tabarani. Now, let's go to explain this hadith. As you know, we are discussing things that nullify the wudu. So here, this hadith is talking about, you know, does sleep nullify the wudu or not? This is the purpose of this, bringing this hadith. As we said, there's different or several hadiths, and every hadith talk or could be taken as proof on one of the rules which is related to al-wudu and what are the things that nullify the wudu. طيب. So in this hadith, there's other ziyada, that mean this hadith, and there's one statement which is not including the hadith that we mentioned, which said, وَمَنْ نَامَ فَلْيَتَوَضَّ. Therefore, the one who slept, then he should what? Perform wudu. Should perform wudu. This extra sentence or statement is not included in this hadith that we mention here. But you can take it from other hadith. طيب, this is why, my dear brothers, always we say, it's not enough just to take one single hadith and then we make rules just from this hadith. Wa alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. طيب. So in this hadith, the explainer of the Sheikh said that from this hadith, talk about the eyes, the eye as a sign if the person is sleeping or not. So if the person, he lose control in his sight to the point that he closed his eyes, that mean he went in a deep sleep. So that's mean there's no control over his stomach, not passing anything, not passing gas. So this is the point here. So here connect the opening of the eyes to the control of one person over whatever that may come out from him. So he said, فَإِذَا نَامَتْ الْعَيْنَانِ فَإِذَا نَامَتْ عَلَكُمْ السَّلَامَ عَلَكُمْ اللَّهِ الْعَيْنَانِ. Notice here, he said, when the two eyes slept. He didn't mention one. فَإِذَا نَامَتْ الْعَيْنَانِ. If the two eyes slept, then the way for passing gas, it will be open. It will be open. We got the point here? So here, he said, talk about the two eyes. Why? Because when the person is really in deep sleep, both eyes are closed. But if just one of them, that means he is still what? Between. Yani he is still between. Yeah, he is drowsing, withdrawing, but he is not sleeping. So look to the hadith, how specific is it? So فَإِذَا نَامَتْ الْعَيْنَانِ. So if the two eyes slept, then the way, you know, for passing anything which may nullify the wudu will be what? Huh? Will be clear. That means that something may come out from this way. طيب. So from this we learn that the type of sleep that nullify the wudu is what? The deep sleeping, that to the point that the person, he loses his conscious. He is not aware of what's going on around him. To the point that both eyes close. Na'am? Right. How can we understand this hadith? We understand this hadith if you compare it to the previous hadith. You remember the hadith which said that at the time of Isha, the Sahaba, the companion of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, they are waiting for the Iqamah, for Salatul Isha, and their heads almost hit the ground, nodding. And then they stand up and they pray, and they don't perform wudu. So that means there is different level of what? Of sleeping, different level. Not any sleep will be considered as in al fire for the wudu. So if the wudu, I mean the person, he is in light sleeping, that he is aware, maybe he's drowning, you know, but he's opened one of his eyes, he know if something happened around him. So this type of sleep will not nullify the wudu. Clear? But if both eyes closed to the point that he relax, he's not aware of what, you know, about himself, this is the type of sleep that will nullify the wudu. That means he should renew his wudu. And confirming this, the extra sentence, which is not mentioned in the hadith of Abi Dawud, which said, then he should renew his wudu. فَلْيَتَوَضَّ مَنْ نَامَ فَمَنْ نَامَ فَلْيَتَوَضَّ. So the one who slept, then he should what? Perform wudu. طيب. طيب. The next hadith, لأبي داود also, إنما الوضوء على من نام مضطجعا. Look at this hadith. Now, before we talk about the eyes as indicator for sleeping, now we talk about the position of sitting, because the position of sitting may help this person to be in control, or he may not control himself, depend on what is the way that he is sitting. So the other hadith لأبي داود also, but the narrator here is Ibn Abbas رضي الله عنهما. Ibn Abbas رضي الله عنه مرفوعا إنما الوضوء على من نام مضطجعا, which means Abu Dawud narrated or transmitted an authority of Ibn Abbas رضي الله عنه, said ablution is obligatory for the one who sleeps lying down. That means if he was sleeping while he's sitting, this will not nullify his wudu according to this. Huh? If he was sitting. But if he was lying down and then he went into deep sleep, then this is the one that he should what? He should renew his wudu. طيب, what's the grade of this hadith? This hadith is weak. This hadith is weak in the chain of narrators. There's problem with the chains of the narrators who narrated this hadith. Again, just to remind you, طيب, and ask you this question again. Then if this hadith is weak, why should we study this hadith and mention it in this book? Or why the author, may Allah have mercy on him, that he reported this hadith if it's weak? Why he didn't eliminate it? Who answer? Excellent. That, because then we should know that there is hadith which say like this. Say maybe somebody will come and say, oh no, you see, you didn't hear the hadith which said that the one who is, you know, lying down, then he should renew his wudu. He said, yes, we know this hadith. We already studied this hadith, but it is weak or da'if, therefore we don't depend on this hadith. And you know, the opinion of the ulama regarding the hadith of da'if. You remember this? We study this when we talk mustalah al-hadith. Remember, we cover this course when we talk studies the mustalah al-hadith, the science of hadith. And we said the ulama of three different views regarding using al-hadith of da'if, the weak hadith. Should we use weak hadith or not? You know, some of them, they said we should not use it at all. And they said we have, alhamdulillah, sufficient numbers of treasure of the sahih hadith. Therefore, why should we turn to the da'if hadith, the weak hadith? Others, this, you know, this is al-Bukhari, like Imam al-Bukhari and some scholars. Others, the second group, they said, we should not use al-hadith al-da'if in rules, when it's a matter of proving, or as proofs, to ahkam, to rules. But it's okay to use these types of hadith to talk about the merits of certain acts of ibadat. Na'am, fada'il. Al-A'mal, Fada'il Al-A'mal, you know, merits of tasbih, merits of doing this or doing that. If there's hadith that encourage people to do it, they said it's okay. And others, they said, we can use both of them. Na'am. But as we said, here, the ulama, the majority of the ulama, they are not in their, taking the hadith da'if as base for any rulings in ahkam. So this is what this, but sometimes the ulama, what they do in books of ahkam, books of fiqh, they report this hadith just to tell you or to inform you that this hadith, if you come across it, so don't depend on it because it is hadith da'if. Na'am. طيب, let's go to the meaning of this hadith according to the Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on him. The Sheikh said, he just add one point. He said, the person who is in fact lying down, he is more likely to be in a deep sleeping because he's already what? Relaxed. But even though we cannot take it as base, maybe if as long as his eyes is open, or one eye is open, then that's mean he's still aware. Even he was lying down. That's mean if something come out from him as wind or something, that's wind, then he will be aware of this. طيب, طيب. The next hadith, عن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم said, يأتي أحدكم الشيطان في صلاته فينفخ في مقعدته فيخيل إليه أنه أحدث ولم يحدث فإذا وجد ذلك فلا ينصرف حتى يسمع صوتا أو يجد ريحا أخرجه البزار وأصله في الصحيحين من حديث عبد الله ابن زيد ابن عبد الله ابن زيد. نعم. The meaning of this hadith, which was narrated also by Ibn Abbas رضي الله عنهما, it said that the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, الشيطان, I'm not going to say devil because all you know what does it mean, شيطان. Okay, الشيطان, the devil, comes to one of you while he is praying. You are in your prayer. While he is praying, and blow in his posterior, the back, blow a wind. So he doubt that he has broken his ablution. So the person, when he feel this, he think what? That he pass wind. He pass wind, or he release some wind. Right. But actually, he has not. Actually, the reality that he didn't. But this is as a result of what? Of the shaitan, which was. So the Prophet ﷺ gave us advice. So how can we make sure that this is reality, huh? Or just matter of doubt? He said, so if anyone experience this feeling, he should not leave his prayer unless he hears a sound or smells something. So now you have a proof that what happened is, huh?
Sound and smell.
Yeah, sound or smell. If there is no sound, no smell, and you are doubt, then just don't pay any attention for this doubt. Clear? But if the person is sure, here we talk about if he's sure or doubt, but if he's really sure that he passed wind, then he should renew his wudu. But he has doubt. Did I? Didn't I? Then he will apply this hadith, or this criterion of his situation. So if he hear sound, it's come from him, or smell something, that means there is no doubt that some wind that's come out from him. Therefore, he should what? He should go and renew his wudu. Clear? Right. So from this, we learn how much the shaitan is trying hard, you know, to abuse your salah. That's mean to keep you busy just to leave your salah. The Muslims, so you should be careful. This is why the Muslim should take good care for preparation for the salah. Why many people, they don't feel the real meaning of khushu'? Because many of them, they come to the salah running. It's the shaitan, the step of the shaitan, take the person step by step. This is the work, the act of the shaitan. He have a strategy. He has very clever strategy. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, what? وَلَا تَتَّبِعُ خُطْوَاتِ الشَّيْطَانِ. Don't follow the steps of the shaitan. Because the shaitan comes step by step. So like the person, if you are a person who doing prayer, alhamdulillah, you are performing your prayer, no problem. So the shaitan will not tell you, don't go to salah. No. When the time of the salah come, and you hear the adhan, he said, oh, sir, there are, you know, this masjid, this imam, always late. So you have 20 minutes. Maybe you can finish this message. Huh? Maybe you can do something in your way. 20 minutes, don't waste your time. And then inshallah no problem, you will get to the salah. And also the first line. If the person is continuing doing this like some people are doing, when they hear the adhan, they still say, no, I just finish this file. I do. And then what happened? And all of a sudden he hear the iqamah. So he come running. And when he come running, and the imam is reading short surah, also he will run more faster. So when he gets in the line, he has no control in himself. Now this is the right time for the shaitan to play a game with him. So he will now work in him, saying, no, you break your wudu. You are running and something come out. See? So this is the way. So this is why the Muslim, the best way to feel the khushu' to feel the real meaning of salah, that the person should prepare for this salah, as early as he can. You should be ready for the salah before the adhan. This is the best thing. You should be in the masjid before the adhan. The adhan just to notify, to wake the sleep, to wake the one who is heedless. For the Muslim, but he knows that this is the time for salah, so he shouldn't head to the masjid. Right. Now, compare all of us, we know ourselves. Compare between yourself when you come early, relax, and the salah start, and you're already comfortable, you stand, you feel the khushu', and somebody who's running, and his breath is in his chest, also fast, so how can we find khushu'? So this is very, very important. So the shaitan always play the game to get you out of your salah because he's an enemy. إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌ فَاتَّخِذُوهُ عَدُوٌ. And the shaitan is your enemy, so you should take him as an enemy. Now, he try hard also, from this hadith, we learn at-tahzir min al-waswas. Because the Prophet ﷺ said, yukhayyal. Yukhayyal, that means he thought, it's not reality. just a matter of imagination. يخيل إليه. نعم. So the Muslim should be aware of this enemy, and always when he starts his salah, he always ask refuge with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the shaitan. This is why before you go to the masjid, you make isti'adah. When you enter the masjid, you know the dua. Huh? What's the dua of the dukhul al-masjid? Huh? Bismillah. As-salatu was-salamu ala rasulillah. Na'am. And then you ask this dua and also ask refuge from the game with the shaitan, the playing with the shaitan. And the same thing when you get out. Na'am. Also when you start your salah, you said, A'udhu billahi min ash-shaitan al-rajim. Na'am. After takbir, before Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, you said, A'udhu billahi istamil a'im min ash-shaitan al-rajim. In this way, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will keep it. The important thing, my dear brothers, that this word, when it's come from the mouth, the person is aware of what he is saying. Because some people, they just repeat this word without thinking. Just as what? As routine, they say. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaitan al-rajim. He didn't remember what he said. طيب. From this hadith, my dear brothers, the ulama, they get very important rule or guideline in ahkam. What is this guideline that we should learn and remember? Al-yaqeenu la yazulu bil-shak. Take it as a golden guideline for yourself in all matters. Al-yaqeen la yazulu bil-shak. What does this mean? That means if you are certain about something, then don't pay any attention for any doubt. Clear? An example. You make wudu al-maghrib. Right? You know that you made the wudu. You are sure about this. And then you went to pray al-maghrib, and you pray the maghrib, alhamdulillah, because you have wudu. And then you are waiting for Isha. When the time of Isha comes, there's doubt come to your mind. Am I have wudu or not? Now this doubt, this something which is doubting what you have. Now you are certain about what? That you have wudu. And this now something's telling you that I'm not sure. So in this case, you depend on what? In your certainty, that you are certain that you had wudu. So don't pay any attention for this doubt. Okay. What did we learn this from this hadith? Because he said, if you are praying in your salah and you felt this matter, don't leave your salah till you hear sound or smell something. Why? Because the Prophet ﷺ is telling you, since you are in salah, that means you already have wudu. Otherwise, you will not be in the salah. Right or not? So I are certain about your wudu. But what happened, what's come up, is that the feeling that something happened, which is not sure, so if there's no evidence that make you sure that you break your wudu, then don't pay any attention for such matter. Is it clear? So remember this guideline. نعم اليقين لا يزول بالشك. The opposite. You know that you didn't have wudu. And when the Salat al-Maghrib come, you said, I don't remember that I have wudu. And you know that you didn't have wudu. You remember that you went to the toilet. And after this, you don't remember, you didn't recall that you make wudu. So you are certain that you don't have wudu. But it said to yourself, I may have wudu. In this case, it depends on what situation? You don't have wudu. Therefore, you should what? Perform wudu. You got it? So this is the rule which everyone should...
The last thing what we remember.
It's not matter of what you remember. But what you are certain.
Yes.
You are certain about. Yes. نعم. طيب. طيب. ولمسلم عن أبي هريرة نحوه. There's in Hadith Muslim, that's mean, this is why he said وأصله في الصحيحين. That's mean the basis for this hadith is already found in the true Sahih. So this hadith is more authentic than the previous one. Huh? Because he said ولمسلم عن أبي هريرة نحوه. That's mean also it was narrated or reported in the book of Imam Muslim through Abu Hurairah رضي الله عنه. Therefore, this will the strength one. وللحاكم عن أبي سعيد مرفوعا. This is another reporter. الحاكم. He said, فإذا جاء أحدكم الشيطان فقال إنك أحدثت فليقل كذبت. Oh, this is different phrase. That's mean if the shaitan come to you and said, you break your wudu, whispering in your mind. You break your wudu. Say to him, you are lying. You are lying. That doesn't mean you say it loudly, everybody in the masjid. Maybe your neighbor, you think that you are talking about him or the imam. This is something inside, within yourself. Within yourself. That's just to tell yourself that you are sure about what you are doing. Na'am? طيب. So from this hadith, as the Sheikh said, there are many benefits. We already mentioned some of them, but he said from this we learn that the Muslim should be very firm when he is dealing with the shaitan, because he is your enemy. He is your enemy. What does it mean, very firm and strong? By be always have self-confidence in yourself. Have a confidence. So don't let or open any leak for him to affect your ibadah or your acts of worship or your life as a Muslim, as a believer. طيب. As conclusion for this, because we have been talking about things that nullify the wudu, the Sheikh, he mentioned some of the fawaid. We already mentioned all these benefits, but he just reminded us of the point that I already discussed before. Does the menstruated woman, can she read the Quran or not? The Sheikh said, there is no evidence in the authentic sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that said the woman at the time of her menses cannot read the Quran. There's no dalil. He said, how come many ulama they talk about it? Those ulama, they took it, they said, since the janaba is hadathun akbar, major impurity, and need to be make, perform ghusl. Huh? And the menses woman also, after she get pure, she take ghusl. So they make the the menstruation equal to what? To the janaba. But for the janaba, we already have evidences that the person in the state of janaba should what? Should perform ghusl. So we cannot apply this, as the Sheikh said here, on the situation of what? Of the woman during her menses. Therefore, from this we learn that if the lady is a teacher or a student, or she want to remember, she may have forgot, because sometimes women, they stay in their menses about maybe 6, 7, maybe 10 days. 10 days. And she want to review her, her hifz. Therefore, it's okay. It is okay to recite the Quran. But without what? Without touching the mushaf. Without touching the Mus'haf. طيب, write this question. This is for you to answer it. Answer it when next week I'll ask you about it. Because you need to go back to this hadith. What does it mean then, the nullifier of the wudu? When you said nawaqid al-wudu, what does it mean? Here I'm talking about definition. What is the meaning of the nullifier of the wudu? Naam? Yeah, the things that nullify the wudu. طيب, if the person is in doubt, is in doubt that he has wudu or not after using the toilet, after he has hadath, what's the hukum? What should he do? طيب. No, no, write the question. Okay? If the person was, he is sure that he has hadith, that means he's not having wudu, should he perform wudu or not? The third question, what is the criteria of the type of sleep that considered as what? As nullifier of wudu. We talk about different types of sleep, right? Which one consider nullifier for the wudu? Or another question, or other word, does any type, any sleep, any level of sleep nullify the wudu or not? Nah. طيب, now we move inshallah. We move to our next chapter, which is Bab Adab Qadha ul Haja, etiquettes of what? For relieving oneself, using toilet, or respond to the call of nature. What are the etiquettes? Now we'll mention different, inshallah, narrations in this regard, inshallah, as we do with all listen. طيب. Chapters, etiquettes of relieving oneself or going to the bathroom. وعن أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه قال كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا دخل الخلاء وضع خاتمه أخرجه الأربعة وهو معلول. Narrated أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه, when Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to the private, that's mean the place where, you know, person he relieve himself, he used to take off his ring, reported by the four imams, but it had deficit in the chain of narrators. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whenever he used the toilet or go to place to relieve himself, he will take off his ring. Who can tell me why? Because the ring, the khatam of the Prophet is the stamp. It is the one, the same that he stamped letter with. And it is written like Muhammad Rasulullah. Muhammad Rasulullah. If you put it in the linguistic order, in the statement as in the language, it should be right Muhammad first, and then Rasul, and then Allah. But the Prophet ﷺ, he wrote it different way. طيب, he put his name down, Muhammad, Rasul, and Allah. The lafz al-jalala, up. So he was taking it because it had the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this, now we learn from this hadith. نعم. So the Sheikh explaining, he said, that means when the Prophet ﷺ is going to the toilet, the place of relieving oneself, he will take off his ring from his finger and put it before he entered to that place. وكان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يتختم إما باليسرى وإما باليمنى. The Sheikh mentioned that this khatam, which the Prophet used to wear it, sometimes he put it in his right hand and sometimes he put it in the left hand. That means it's not always in the same place. And mostly was in his left hand more than the right hand. This is according to different reports from the Sahaba. طيب, why the Prophet ﷺ used this? Because you remember the Prophet ﷺ in Da'wa, after he settled in Medina, he sent letters to leaders of the world at that time. So he sent a letter to Kisra and to Caesar, Caesar of Roman, and he sent to Al-Muqawqas, Azim Al-Qibt, and he sent another letter for Al-Najashi, the king of Basina and Habasha at that time. So they told the Prophet ﷺ, O Prophet of Allah, it is, as they call, the protocol for these kings and leaders, that they don't accept any message or any letter without stamp. Without stamp. A stamp. Should be stamp. Otherwise, they don't pay any attention for it. So the Prophet ﷺ, he took this khatam, which written with his name, to stamp. So when, as you know, the Prophet ﷺ, he doesn't read or write. So he command one of his scribers, writers, Sahaba, to write it down, to write the letter to this. And then he stamped it with his stamp, alayhi salatu wassalam. Na'am. So this, the Sheikh just, you know, is telling us what the reason that the Prophet ﷺ, he used this khatam. طيب. From this hadith, we learn different matters. First of all, جواز لبس الخاتم. That means it is permissible for the Muslim to wear ring, to put ring in his fingers. But is it any ring?
Silver.
Huh?
Silver.
Anything except
gold.
You see, this is what we always, my dear brothers, we said, sometimes you take the dalil, which what they call dalilun am, general dalil. But there are other hadith, other proofs that specify the conditions of this general rule. So from this, when you said, well, it is allowed to wear khatam, but this not the end of the issue. That then you should know and understand that there are certain criteria or certain conditions for such ring. That means for the Muslim, men, not women, are not allowed to put any ring made out of gold. Some people nowadays, some Muslim, they put this ring, what they call it, wedding ring. When you tell them, Ya Sheikh, this is haram, they say, no, this is a wedding ring. But even though, why should you make it of gold? First of all, this is, you know, this is imitation of the kuffar, because it's not the way of the Muslim that they have this ring in when they get wedding. The kuffar, because, you know, because their life is open, so sometimes they get together in parties, in meetings, and so they use bit this as a sign, huh, that the man is married. So women will not approach him. This is one of the reasons. Yani. I'm not saying that this is the reason, but this is one of the reasons. So it will be identified. This is why the people, the first thing they look at what? Women, they look at the hand of the man. Aha, you are married. And this is why men who want to cheat, what they do? They remove it, put it in their pocket. Or keep it in their cars when they go. Nasallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from this. So the Muslim is not in need for this to put a sign that he is married. Why? Because first of all, he is not mixed. And the Muslim never cheat because he fear from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not from people. Anyway, so this is, if somebody said it is bid'ah, we are not talking about bid'ah because it's not in the religion. But we take it as what? Not imitating the kuffar. But if it's come as a habit in the community, like these days, we should not be very tough with those young people, telling them, you know, this is, take it, or it's just become as a practice, general practice. But we remind them that this is not the way, you know, in the Muslim culture. Anyway, If the person, he wear this ring, he should make sure that it's not made of what?
Gold.
Of gold. This is for men. But for women, it's okay. Now, right. Also, we learn from this hadith that it's not allowed or it's prohibited to enter the toilet with anything which is what? Written with the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or any of the Quran, any of the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. طيب, how about this devices, mobile? But the full Quran is in this device. If it was turned off or the application is not on, then it's no problem because it's not in fact writing here. It's electric, waves only. So it's closed. But don't open, you were reciting the Quran from your room mobile and you get there while it's open. If you turn it off, it's okay. Got it? طيب. If the person, he has something which is, has the name of Allah, like nowadays, you know, there's money sometimes, which is written, maybe the name of Allah. Should you leave it outside so you'll not get it in? If you come out, you may not find it. So in case that you have something which you are afraid of, like books or anything, then it's better, you know, to rub it or to put it inside something and try, especially if you are traveling, you know, in the airport. You are afraid to put it outside, otherwise maybe it will be taken. Maybe the security, they think who's, this belongs to whom, and it will be troubled. So this is different. So the Muslim should fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as much as he can. طيب. طيب. The Sheikh said, it's not here, this command is not to make it prohibited, as we mentioned, but it is a matter of preferness. I mean, istihbab. It will be better not to, wa alaykum as-salam, not to use it. Now I'm answering some people at the Facebook, somehow, or students are following us. Okay. Don't be surprised. I don't think that I saw an angel getting from there. Yeah. Because some people, you know, they said, oh, was it? Our teacher. Yeah, all the teacher, all of a sudden, he said, alaykum as-salam. And nobody comment. No, some brothers and sisters, when they come, they say, assalamu alaykum, and we have to answer this. If I noticed this, sometimes I didn't notice this. Okay. طيب. So the Sheikh said here, this command, it's not for to make it prohibited to enter with this, but as a matter of preference. Huh? So in this case, we should not make it very tough for people. If you have something that you are afraid that it will be stolen, then try to rub it and you can get in with it and don't leave it for somebody to take it away. طيب. طيب. How about the Mus'haf itself? The Mus'haf, the Sheikh said, العلماء صرحوا بين دخول المدخل محرم. He said it is محرم, to get the Mus'haf inside. نعم. But you know, like many people, his name is Abdullah, his credit, his card with the name of Abdullah, the driver license with the name of Abdullah, like yourself, huh? Abdullah. So it's hard, you know, to put all your cards, whatever you have, with your names or outside. So you can keep it in. But for the Mus'haf itself, that's mean the book, then it's not to get it in. طيب. The next hadith. نعم. طيب. The Sheikh, he didn't mention. He let's go to what he said. Did I mention that it's ma'lul? Ma'lul. That's mean when ma'lul, that's mean there's illa. That's mean there's deficit. Al-illa, sometimes, it depends. We discussed this in our study for science of hadith. Al-illa is different. There's illatun qadihah. وعلة غير قادحة. What does it mean, the difference between العلة القادحة which is the real major deficit and علة غير قادحة which is very minor. نعم. But here he didn't mention what type of علة is there. But as conclusion, we learn from this that if the person, the important thing, that it is not forbidden to the point that the person should sacrifice something of his own and leave it outside for people, for thieves to take it. It's not to this point. But we said, if you can get in without it, that will be what? Yeah, that would be better. Nah. Okay. How much time we have before Adhan?
4 minutes.
4 minutes? Okay. We finish with the hadith, Dua الخلاء. وعنه رضي الله عنه قال كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا دخل الخلاء قال اللهم إني أعوذ بك من الخبث والخبائث أخرجه السبعة. That means this is the most strong hadith. Seven of the reporters of the hadith, they reported this hadith. البخاري ومسلم وأحمد وأبو داود والترمذي والنسائي وابن ماجه. All of them, they reported this hadith. This is why it is highly recommended for every Muslim to memorize this hadith. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min al-khubthi wal-khaba'ith. Naam? What's the meaning of this hadith? This hadith also narrated by Anas. It means, oh Allah, I seek refuge in you from male and female devils. Related by the seven imams, reported. نعم. طيب. I seek refuge. طيب. الخبث والخبائث. That's mean male and female. قال إذا دخل الخلاء. When enter. Does this mean that when he enter there he say this dua? Because it's huh? That's mean before he get in. إذا دخل, that means if he intend, I mean he want to get into the toilet. Before he get in, he say this dua. نعم. الخلاء, this is the Arabic called الخلاء, that mean empty space. خلاء, this is خلاء. This is why they call the desert الخلاء. And I think in Urdu they call it Bayt al-Khala, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. This is Arabic word. Old for the Arab they call it this for Bayt al-Khala. This is Arabic. Originally, yeah. Bayt al-Khala. They say the place of Khala, either that's mean it's empty space like the desert, or Bayt al-Khala, that's mean the person will be alone with himself. That's mean he Khala from the people. He's not mixed with people. So he's alone. So either way it's come. بيت الخلاء, that means his place where he is alone. خلاء, nobody around him. Okay? Or, as I said, because that's empty space. This is why they call it, the Arabs before, as you know, they don't have toilets at their homes. So whenever they want to use the relief themselves, what they do? They go outside. They go outside. And women at that time, they are suffering. Because some of them, they wait till it is evening or night to go to relieve themselves. Naam. But as you know, at that time it's not like our situation. MashaAllah, we eat three meals every day, and between the meals there are some snacks. So the person, he go to the to relieve himself more than once. Maybe they stay 1 or 2 days without relieving them once, because of they just eat very, very, very relaxing. Anyway. إذا دخل الخلاء, that's mean when he قال إني أعوذ بك, that's mean I seek refuge with you. أعتصم بك. Oh Allah, I seek your help and protection from these evils or these devils. نعم. أعتصم بك. طيب. Sometimes you may hear this word, a'udhu wa aludhu. What's the difference between a'udhu wa aludhu? A'udhu, you seek refuge. Wa aludhu, you are get closer to or depend on to be protected with. You see? So a'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. Wa aludhu, that means also I get closer to him to be supported. Nah. فيقول عذت من فلان. نعم. Like عذت بفلان من شر فلان. عذت بفلان من شر فلان. نعم. طيب. Let's go to the last point here. We'll finish the hadith inshallah and then we'll stop, okay? طيب. If the person forgot and he didn't say this hadith, this dua, the Sheikh mentioned this issue. لو نسي الإنسان أن يقول هذا الذكر ودخل فهل نقول قل هذا الذكر وأنت should you say it inside? Huh? A person, he used to say this dua, أعوذ بالله اللهم أني أعوذ من خلق. But he didn't remember till he get and he was relieving himself. Should he say it at that time? No, it's not. It's not. Anyway, inshallah, we'll continue next week. You know, this is a hadith and there are many benefits in this hadith. Okay? جزاكم الله خير. ولا keep the question after the adhan, okay?